As they came towards Boadilla and the main road, all orders were to cover their retreat and hold their positions until further orders. But the order to withdraw soon came. We did so by sections, one covering the other with fire as it came back. As our section was moving back, dragging the gun, I felt a shocking blow and a burning pain through my neck and right shoulder, and fell to the ground in my back with blocks burning like a fountain. John came back with David, our Oxford man who had been a medical student. I heard him say, "I can't do anything about that." And John bent down and said, "God bless you, Bernard," and left. They had to go. They had to set up the gun and cover the withdrawal of our other crew. And they were sure that I was dying. Good morning, I'm Pep, and this is the Spanish Civil War. In this channel, and for the next 3 years, we will follow week by week the Spanish Civil War, its battles, and the Holocaust that it provoked. Last week, we saw how the strategic offensive against Victoria that faded already during its first week continued to claim lives and lives in the struggle for the haste in the area surrounding Villareal. The Loyalist artillery pounded the Francoist defenders, but the idea of capturing the village was already going to their minds. We also saw how Alvarez del Vayo denounced the Spanish situation in front of the League of Nations, particularly the German and Italian intervention. We talked about how each Spain refused the proposal of international intervention, and we promised you yet another battle for the A Coruña road. And even if it's not the only battle that starts this week, we'll start with it. We've already covered the first battle for the A Coruña road. It was conceived with the aim of protecting the nationalist precarious flag in Madrid to go back to the war of movement and capture positions that would become starting positions for another attack that could circle Madrid from the west, cutting also the capital from the troops that were defending the Guadarrama Ridge. The attack, even if the nationalist forces had numerical superiority, abysmal when it's time to talk about austerity, failed utterly, and the Loyalist 3rd Mixed Brigade managed to obtain a defensive victory for the Republic, even if it was almost destroyed. During the first battle for the A Coruña road, the action was concentrated in the area of Pozuelo, as we've seen in our map a while ago. Now the action will take place to the west of Pozuelo. The main offensive will go from Quijorna to Villanueva de la Calzada and then Villanueva del Pardillo, and from Villaviciosa to Boadilla and Majadahonda, in order to cross the Manzanares. The Francoist attacking forces are divided in 5 columns. The 3 main ones under Monasterio, Barrón and Sáenz de Buruaga will be composed by 15 battalions, 9 cavalry squadrons, 52 cannons, 2 Panzer I company, 4 sections of engineers, for a total number of 10,000 troops. These 3 columns would be covered by the Ávila division in the left flank and the column of Ciro Alonso at the right flank. Covering the sector of the front chosen by the Francoists to attack, we could find the 35th Mixed Brigade under Barceló, whom we've seen trying to seize the Alcázar back in September. He had under his command about 5,000 men and probably around 6 pieces of artillery. The 14th, after one day of delay because of the fog, the nationalist forces start their advance, even though the battle is known as the Battle of the Fog for some reason, and by midday the 14th, there is still a dense fog. By dusk, the troops of Sáenz de Buruaga reach Boadilla and manage to capture some houses. The next day, when it's clear that the nationalist attack is threatening Barceló, the 11th International Brigade is sent in as reinforcements. Luckily for the defenders, the fog decreases the accuracy of nationalist artillery and prevents any aerial operation. The 16th, the weather changes, and with it the lack of the troops that are defending Boadilla. With the artillery and aerial support, the Francoist forces managed to dislodge the Republicans from the village. The Talman and the Dombrowski battalion that were defending the city left 78 dead behind. Just 2 British remained alive from the first company of the Talman battalion. We started our episode with the witness of Bernard Knox, British author that took part in the fight for Boadilla as one of the political commissars of the 11th International Brigade, and that was wounded during the fray. Rojo, that was preparing a counterattack with some reinforcement he had gathered, among them the 12th International Brigade, two battalions, a section of machine guns and a section of tanks, has no other choice than to throw them in order to close the gap caused by the fall of Boadilla. And it will be the first time that the 11th International Brigade will fight alongside the 12th. During the next 2 days, the fog again will prevent any further advance by the Francoist troops, as no air nor artillery support is available. The Loyalist forces use that precious time to entrench themselves at the north of Boadilla and continue to reinforce. The 19th, the Nationalists resume their attack again, but they find an entrenched and reinforced enemy in front of them. Monasterio's troops manage to capture Villanueva de la Cañada, and by the end of the week, they are just 2 kilometers away from Villafranca del Castillo. But we'll have to wait until next week to see if these advances are enough to break the Republican defensive system, or if it will hold. Last week, we promised you another battle for the Coruña road, but we didn't tell you that another offensive also starts this week. The Aceituna Olive Campaign. Queipo, with his Army of the South, has been planning an operation in order to gain control over the olive fields in the surroundings of Andújar, in order to shorten the distance between his territory and the besieged National Civil Guards of the Sanctuary of Santa Maria de la Cabeza. Yes, we talk about them and they are still under siege. The 15th, Queipo's troops, a mix of Carlists and Regulares, 2,000 strong, start their advance from Baena and manage to capture, with not so much difficulties, the village of Albacín. During the next couple of days, no important progress is made as the Francoist finds stiff resistance, even though the 19th, Valenzuela and Cañete fall. By the end of the week, with the fall of Bujalance and the departure of another Nationalist column from Córdoba, the Republican situation seems dire and they fear a breakthrough in the south. The Nationalist advance have been considerable and they have total air superiority. The Republican High Command does not consider the situation so dangerous. It has been gathering troops for an offensive on their own in the south. So if the situation gets worse, these troops will be used to establish the front. And wherever there's fight, we can find international brigades. But to see the newly created 14th International Brigade role in this campaign, and if there is a breakthrough or not, we'll have to wait until the next week. Another battle that has been raging during 2 weeks already in the north of Spain, the battle for Villareal. Both sides are exhausted, and the defeat for the Republicans is bitter and hard to accept. The 18th, they make a last attempt to break through the enemy lines in the sector of Testafe and Nafarrete, but to no avail. The Socialist battalion Largo Caballero will leave 50 deaths behind. Even if the Battle of Villarreal is considered to end by the 24th of December, with the Francoist forces managing to recover their lost ground, we'll close the chapter this week with this last Republican attempt. As said in our previous episodes, the lack of experience of the Basque troops played a fundamental role in their defeat. Their countless frontal assaults against entrenched enemy positions took a high toll on them. According to Segarra, 14% of the casualties of the Army of the North during the whole war were a result of the battle for Villarreal. As we said months ago, it is not possible to create an army by decree. This week has been an exciting week in the fields of Spain, with a strategic offensive in the north that is ending and two offensives, one in the center and one in the south, that are starting. But that's not all we have to talk about this week. In the seas, we've seen last week how the Republican submarine C-33 was sunk by the German U-34 that was near the Spanish coast without any identificative sign. This week, it will be the turn of the Russian mercant Kosmosol that was carrying weapons for the Republic, and that will meet the bottom of the sea, courtesy of the Canarias. In the international stage, we've left last week the non-intervention committee finding itself with some difficulties with any Spaniard accepting their mediation proposal. Meanwhile, Alvarez del Vayo denounced the German and Italian intervention in front of the League of Nations. These international talks did not impede the United Kingdom to sign its first commercial agreement with Franco this week, nor Mussolini and Canaries to plan the next phase of their intervention, and starting to embark this week also in Italy and directed towards Spain 3,000 Italian troops that will become the backbone of the CTV, also in the international stage, favoring Francoist international legitimation and following the example of Nazi Germany and Fascist Italy, and also some Latin American countries, the Vatican officially recognizes Franco's government. In the rearguard this week, we won't talk about deaths, even if they continue to happen, but about treason and power struggles. As said in our first episode, the myth of a communist Spain that had to be saved by the army is no more than that, a myth. Communism, and in particular Stalinism, started to spread and gain adepts in Spain after the coup, not before. With the communist defense of private property, the defense of the bourgeois republic, the discipline of his troops, and of course the Russian war material and their advisors, communists gained power. The purge, as the one that will take place very soon in the USSR, is, also in Spain, a matter of time. Gaining power for every 5 Russian ballot, the communists will start with the publication this week of their 8 conditions for the victory, their political campaign, and purge. In Catalonia, they will start the prosecution against the POM, and this week, Andreu Nin will resign his position in the Catalan government. The anarchists don't feel the danger within yet, thinking it's just a purge between communists, ignoring they may be the next ones in the list. But not only in the Republican rearguard there's a struggle for power. Back in October, and later in November, with the death of José Antonio Primo de Rivera, we've talked about the movements that took Franco, the general that joined the rebellion at the last moment, to rise among his peers and become the head of the rebel Spain. We've said that he had very clear from the beginning that he needed to control the different realities that could be found inside the nationalist Spain, and that he needed to eliminate or avoid giving too much credit to the figures that could threaten his position. Having this in mind, last week Juan de Borbón, son of Alfonso XIII and heir to the throne of Spain, asked Franco if he could join the crew of the Spanish cruiser Baleares. Juan de Borbón had served in the Royal Navy. Franco, very politely, will answer that this kind of risk should not be taken, keeping away Juan from Spain. And he's not the only one that will have to remain away from Spain, because this week Manuel Falcone, leader of the Carlists, exiles himself in Portugal. The Carlists had lost a winning hand with the death of Sanjurjo, descendant of Carlists and leader of the coup. They were involved in the conspiracy and preparations for the coup since the beginning, but they had also a very defined identity, ideology and objectives. In fact, during the first months of the war, under the Carlist rule in Navarra, they tried to develop his own fascist corporative state last week, and as agreed with Mola long ago, they've decided to create the Royal Military Academy for the Requete in order to train their officers for the militias. Well, that was perceived by Franco as something that could give autonomy to the Carlists and therefore threaten his leadership. He did not hesitate to consider this as a treason. An agreement was of course needed between the nationalist side, but the wound was open. There was too much for the Carlists. Among their leader Falcone, even if the Count of Rodenzo, another important Carlist, pushed to implement Franco's agenda, it was difficult, and Falcone will leave Spain. I've been working for a while to bring you a special episode about the Carlists and this history, and their history beyond the Spanish Civil War, the different factions and power struggles since the 1830s till today. And we hope we'll have time to finish it soon. With this promise, we reach the end of the week. Next week, it will be Christmas. And as the Great War, each warring side thought that the war would be over by Christmas. Thousands of them even thought there would be no war. But that's mankind, isn't it? Please, don't forget to subscribe, to like our video. If you enjoy it, share it. We have to bring light to the history of Spain. If you are able to support us in our Patreon channel, as these heroes already did, or offer us a coffee, this would also be great and would help us to carry on and improve the project. Let's make this possible all together. Thanks for your attention. Goodbye and salute.